Today, I am happy to say that we are excited to welcome back to the table one of my favorite people, Mr. Jean Paul Francoeur, affectionately known to the world as simply JP. The last time we interviewed him was in 2017. JP is one of the top fitness authorities in Arkansas and beyond. In 2008, burned out, he sold his thriving high-end health club atop the TCBY Tower building in downtown Little Rock and recreated himself, becoming the golf performance and functional training specialist at Alotion Golf Club. Today, he is back in entrepreneurial mode by opening a new gym as a certified NeuFit therapist, helping people put on muscle, circumvent health problems, and recover from injuries and chronic pain. You may have seen or heard of JP already. He's been featured in Parade magazine twice, as well as USA Today. He has been a freelance writer for health magazines and websites, having been published in both Men's Health and Best Life magazines, just to name a few. He was a top fitness advisor to former Governor Mike Huckabee's well-publicized weight loss program, Stop Digging Your Own Grave with a Knife and Fork, and served as chairman of the Arkansas Governor's School on Fitness. You're exactly right. And served as chairman of the Arkansas Governor's Council for 8 years. And served as chairman of the Arkansas Governor's Council on Fitness for 8 years. It is my pleasure to welcome to the table a man that has dedicated his life to helping others through physical fitness, my longtime friend and my current personal trainer, Mr. Jean Paul Francoeur.
Feel like I need some theme music here.
Da-da-da-da. That's for post.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll put that
we'll
do that.
We'll put that in post.
We will. So I'm always amazed at how many entrepreneurs didn't necessarily go to college or grow up rich. I mentioned it in the opening. It's kind of amazing. And I listened to our 2017 show. And by the way, thank you for coming back on.
You're welcome. I'm happy to be here.
Before we talk about your entrepreneurial story, which you could go back and listen to it because it's really good. I was fascinated. I've known you for 30 years, but I kind of forgot all the details about how you started. You have just opened today, though, yet another gym in Little Rock, Arkansas. You just opened it a couple of months ago and revamped your website. This is not really what I would call a gym. This is one-on-one personal training with some high-end equipment. All right, let's go. What is NeuFit Therapy?
Okay, so NeuFit is a combination of neurology and fitness. And the newbie is the device that we use, and it's a direct current electrical stim device. From a therapy standpoint, it's different. We use it for both therapy and for fitness. So from a therapy standpoint, someone comes in who, say, has an injured shoulder, like a real common one is a torn supraspinatus, which just, you know, impinges when they're trying to bench press or something like that.
Is that
just
your shoulder?
Yeah, it's in the shoulder. Yeah.
Supraspinatus.
It's an external rotator. It's a real small, easy, it's easy to tear. So many people come in with that. It's like a real common one. We try to help people.
You think that's what my husband Grady tore when he fell down the back steps in the ice storm?
I don't know. Since he didn't get an MRI, we'll never know. He might have.
So he did that about 8 months ago, and I cannot believe how much the NeuFit has helped him recover and get his full range back in his shoulder.
Right.
All right. So keep telling everybody.
Okay. So when you go to traditional physical therapy, they're going to take you through some, you know, range of motion exercises, kind of progressively loading you, kind of building your range of motion. But they're treating basically the pain, which is a symptom. It's not the actual root cause of the problem. And so they can get you some relief and they might get you out of pain. It might take you 6 weeks. It might take you several months. Most of the people who come to me have been through the whole racket for a while, and they've been through physical therapy, you know, once or twice, and they just haven't gotten back to where they feel like they're out of pain and able to perform. So when they end up in my lap, we have a completely different process. So we're not physical therapy. We are actually, I guess we're just, you know, still it, the basic idea is that when you have, problem with performance, you've got a weakness problem somewhere else in your body. So there's something in your body that isn't a broken link, you know, somewhere where your nervous system isn't getting a good signal, where you're not getting good blood supply. So what we do is a scanning process where we map your body, and we've got one pad on you as a ground, and then we're scanning you with the other pad. I call it lawnmowing. We're just scanning. We're looking across your whole.
So I want to tell everybody what a pad is. So if you go to your website, you can see that you have somebody wired up with these pads.
Yes.
And they're just kind of.
They're electrodes. We got sticky pads, and then we've got like when I'm doing scanning, I use a rubber carbon pad with a wet sponge.
It's kind of like when you go in and they want to do
EKG.
EKG on you, and they put those little pads on you. So they're kind of like that. You put them on you.
They look that way. Of course, they're not. They're different.
They're not. Though. They are different. Yeah. And they're 2 by 3 inches, and mm-hmm. you put them on your muscle because you mm-hmm. know so much about muscles, and you mm-hmm. put them on your muscles. And you train the body. But now that you're looking for a mistake.
When I'm scanning for the root cause of a problem,
okay.
that's where it's very different. Like in physical therapy, you know, you have a person with a torn supraspinatus, torn rotator, and they're going to go in, they're going to do the exact same therapy as the other 10 people who have a torn rotator. With us, we're going to find out why you have that torn rotator, and it's not going to be the same exact treatment as the other person because our bodies are all very unique. So we're looking for, so one person might have a problem that's down in their, you know, their arm or close to their elbow. Another person might have a problem back in their scapula. So we're going to scan and we're going to find out where the real problem is, and the way that shows up is we're sending a signal with that pad to whatever area where the pad is moving. Whatever area that pad is on is sending a signal that the brain interprets as loaded movement. So if the tissue is healthy, then your brain says, oh, that's fine. It just kind of tingles. But when I get over an area that your brain is trying to protect, then I see you try to get away from it. I immediately see you go into compensation, or you might say, ow, get that away from me. So that's actually how we identify the areas to treat. So once we've identified those, basically what areas are not communicating with each other, this is where the whole neuromuscular reeducation process starts up, because what we're trying to do is teach the body to be able to load in a pattern that it's been, that it gets a pain signal when it tries to move in that movement pattern. And, but now we're re-educating it because we're teaching the brain that it can load those muscles now. And it starts to feel, as I'm cranking the machine up, it actually starts to feel a little easier, because you're adapting. As I increase the load, your brain is basically saying, oh, that's, I was trying to protect, but now I can see that I can get in that position, and oh, well, I guess I can let down some of these governors. So in essence, we're just teaching the brain that it can start removing these governors that it puts in place to keep us from moving in areas that it's trying to, that it feels like it's trying to protect. So it's really about protection patterns. It's all about, you know, pain.
So Grady fell down the steps,
mm-hmm.
hurt his shoulder, rotator mm-hmm. cuff, I guess, or something, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
He comes into you. He can't lift his arm over his head.
He couldn't lift his arm 45 degrees away from his body.
He couldn't even put his shirt on hardly. And he comes mm-hmm. in, and the first thing you want to do is go to his shoulder because you think that's where we need to work. And
right.
I think you're saying that that's where most physical therapists would go.
Well, that's where the traditional, I'm mind you, I'm not slamming physical
right.
therapy. You know, I mean, they obviously are, you know, go to work and go to school for a very long time. I do think the industry is sort of hampered by the insurance industry, medical insurance, because they dictate so many times, you know, this is what they have. So this is the treatment that we're going to pay for. So people end up with these kind of like, you know,
cookie cutter kind of.
Thank you. That was the word I was looking for.
Yeah, cookie cutter kind of.
Just total cookie cutter, and not really addressing, not really listening to their body and trying to do what they need. And so
you put these pads on Grady's shoulder.
Mm-hmm. So I scanned and I identified where his hotspots were.
So when you put the pads on his shoulders, mm-hmm. you were sending current through his shoulder.
I was sending current through, I don't think it was his shoulder. I think his hotspot was down in his arm.
Well, then you took another pad.
We always put a ground pad, usually on the lower back, and then we scan. I start where the pain is, just to really to identify to them, show them that it doesn't actually hurt when they're on the injury, because the pad is only going to, the signal from the pad is only going to be interpreted as pain if it's on an area where you're not. Where,
so you could put the grounding pad on his back.
I put the ground on his back and then I scan his body.
With another pad.
With the other pad. And I find his primary, you know, hot spot is what we call them. We call them hot spots, or where the primary disconnect is.
Where the pain is.
Well, it's not where the pain is. It's where the, it's the root cause of the pain.
Right.
So the pain is in the shoulder, but the root cause of the problem is somewhere else. So,
you put the pad on his back as the grounding pad.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to paint a picture for the listener. And then you took this other pad and you put it on his shoulder.
Yeah, I scanned.
Nothing.
It was
where
tingling.
Where he was hampered.
Yeah.
On his shoulder. And then you started going down his arms. And as you got down his arm, he flew off the table. It just was like a jolt. And you're like, okay. You're compensating right here, and here's your hot spot. This is what we're going to work on. And it was so counterintuitive.
It would seem that way, obviously to me, I've been doing this for so long, it's very logical. What we're trying to do is like I said, reconnect these areas. It's kind of like yoga. I mean, not yoga. It's kind of like acupuncture with a load. You know, acupuncture is about identifying these sort of broken meridians. You know, our bodies are electric. And, you know, I guess the people who came up with acupuncture 2000 years ago or longer, understood that, and you know, intuitively just understood that. And so they figured out how to sort of reconnect our electrical, you know, connections in the body. But the difference with what we do is we can identify where those broken meridians are, just for lack of a better phrase. But we can also load the pattern. So we can actually, I can crank up the output, and it's like cranking up the weight. So I can simulate lifting weight or whatever, making those areas bear weight. So it's kind of like I can make you adapt a little bit faster.
Without ever lifting weight.
Without having to lift a weight. Right.
Without having to damage anything.
Right. We're not putting any, and what I typically do is then I go through what I call mobilization exercises. I start with some basic ones that are sort of normal, just get the shoulder moving. But then I go to exercises that are in the range of motion where they are typically avoiding, like something that would hurt. So if it hurts to scratch your back, you know, if you can't get your arm back there, then I'm going to have you doing some exercises like that. Or if it hurts to, you know, fasten your seatbelt, I'm going to have you simulate fastening a seatbelt. If it hurts to draw your sword, I'm going to have you do some sword pulls, you know. You know, I'm just going to find the areas
it hurts
that you're
to bring up. Curl your beer to your mouth.
Exactly.
We're going to curl beers to our mouth.
Exactly. We're going to find the movement pattern that your body is trying to protect against. And we're going to have you work in that range. And then I'm going to keep increasing the load as you adapt. And so that you just keep, and the higher I can get you in something like this, usually the better and faster the outcome. Because you feel the difference immediately. Like that's one of the things that I love about this is that you feel the needle move day one. There's no question about it. You can come in at a 6 or 7 in pain, really limited in your range of motion. And by the end of the session, you're like at a 1 or a 2 and you can raise your arm overhead and you're just like totally, moving.
It's bizarre.
Yeah.
But then it starts to kind of creep back because your muscles start compensating.
Well, so what happens is the reason when I do therapy, it's a little different than training. Like I can train somebody, you know, a couple of times a week and get really great results.
And we'll get into muscle training.
I'm talking about the fitness part of things.
Right.
Yeah, that's different. I can do that a couple times a week. But when I'm trying to do therapy on someone who's got an injury, then I usually want to get those sessions closer together because we're trying to overwrite old neurological patterns, right? We're trying, so they're pretty etched in. If it's chronic, especially, it's pretty etched in. So
muscles have memory,
right? And so what we're trying to do. So when you feel that needle move, I might get you down to a 2, and then ten hours later, 11 hours later, you might start to regress a little bit because your body likes to repeat these patterns. It's all about patterns. You know, our brains are pattern recognition machines, and so we try to go back into that old pattern because it's familiar to us. And so why I like to get in there and do another therapy session is as you start to regress, you might get back up to a 4. Well, then I can catch you and bring you back down to like a 1 or a 0. And then you might regress up to a 2. And then I can get, and then eventually I start closing that gap where you come in and you haven't regressed at all. And when you have when you show up a couple of times in a row without any, where you have not regressed and you're still kind of where you were when you left, then I know it's time to start bridging into more strengthening. So the steps are basically, first step is we want to get your body in balance, which is what I do with my activations, the little muscle activation techniques where mm-hmm. I test to make sure that, you know, try to get everything firing it that I can. Then I do the machine to remove hot spots. And then the third stage is increase neurological strength. And the last stage is to increase physical strength. So neurological strength.
What is that?
So basically, like your ability to hold positions, like at your end range or something like that. Like if you have a injured shoulder, it might have you holding your arm out in front of you or holding it out the side with maybe even with a little bit of resistance.
And that's
weight.
Neurological.
Yeah. So I want you doing basically ISO exercises to try to build, you know, and then while I'm increasing the load, it's going to try to pull you out of position. Your job is to sort of fight against the machine and keep yourself in the correct position. And as you do that, that's where the whole neuromuscular reeducation process takes place.
This makes me want to ask, when are we going to start being able to put this on our heads and remap the way we think? if our brains are just, what did
there
you?
There are different ways of doing that actually, but I'm not, that's not in the technology that I use. I use there is one of the processes that I do. We have several things that we do. Like I'm explaining just a basic orthopedic injury rehab situation. Mm-hmm. But if somebody is just really, really stressed, and you can usually tell, you know, mm-hmm. We'll use one of our procedures is called a master reset. And I put black pads down on the balls of the feet and I put red pads up on the neck right by the spinal cord. Two of the most neurologically dense areas of the body. And I put it on a gentle current driving a current up from through the black up to the red and
from your feet up to
your
head.
Feet up to your head. And it's, and do that for about 20 to 30 minutes while having you lay flat and just close your eyes and do some deep breathing exercises. I sort of teach you some stuff on, you know, how to do diaphragmatic breathing or belly breathing.
And that changes your stress level.
It actually does. It helps induce what's called a parasympathetic state. So you've got two branches of the autonomic nervous system. You've got fight or flight, which is sympathetic, or rest and digest, which is parasympathetic. And so with the reset, we can help induce a parasympathetic state. We can upregulate parasympathetic activity. So it stimulates like all these important nerves, like your vagus nerve and things like that. It helps that help regulate, you know, a lot of things in your body, you know, your temperature, your metabolism. I mean, just all these different things.
Why haven't I done that?
I think you have.
Oh, is there anything for memory?
Well, so the thing about a reset is it is like a little cognitive boost. Like when people get done with this, they feel amazing. They feel like they're ready to seize the day. And it just gets you out of that stressful state. Because when you're stressed out like that, the most important measure is your heart rate variability. And so this can actually, like when I test people, for people who have devices, you know, like wearables, like I have a BioStrap, other people have Whoop or an Aura Ring. These are different devices. And actually, even Apple Watch now, you can actually do it before and after. And you can see the stress factor come down and you can see the heart rate variability increase. And you want high level of heart rate variability as you can get. That means that your body is, you know, neuroplastic and ready to adapt to stress and you're ready for whatever.
So you say that there is something we could do for people with depression or PTSD that can possibly maybe, I see this advancing to where you could put it on your brain because they're doing more and more brain research.
I mean, not with a NeuFit, there are different technologies coming down the pike.
I mean, we used to do shock therapy. Mm-hmm. I mean, they were kind of getting close to that, but it was unpredictable and mm-hmm. you never knew what it was going to do. But seems like this could be the modern shock therapy to kind of remap the way you think.
It is. And I'll tell you how I see it as working, because I actually recently read, well, not recently, a couple of years ago. It feels recent to me. I read a book by Dr. Vanderkolk called The Body Keeps the Score. And he's the world's leading expert on trauma. And so basically, after reading that, I saw where NeuFit would fit in a sense that, you know, a lot of times people have, you know, these severe body pains, and it might not be, there might not be a pathology explaining it, but, you know, they might have a trauma connected to that pain, but the beauty of what we're doing is that we can help adapt the brain and the body to loading these areas again and using them without pain. So it's kind of what Van der Kolk would probably call a bottom up therapy. Instead of like a talk therapy, which is a top down therapy, we're doing a bottom up therapy where we can actually teach the brain to adapt to being able to move without protecting. And so if we can help remove some of those protective governors that the brain puts in place, then we can actually help with the actual trauma that they're dealing with.
So many things about Western medicine, excuse me, is about treating the symptoms instead mm-hmm. of going to the root problem.
Right, right. I mean, that's the really is the that's at the heart of, you know, Western medicine. And I'm not, again, I'm not criticizing. I go to the doctor, you know, just like anybody else. If I get a cold, or, you know, I just recently had a surgery on my foot, you know, for damaged tissue. And so, you know, there are things that we can definitely prevent. You know, a lot of people come to me and I've had people coming in scheduled for knee surgery that ended up not having knee surgery because we were able to get them the right muscles firing in sequence where they weren't loading their knee incorrectly in the first place. And so they were out of pain. They were able to do all the things that they were able to do.
It's like you have a bad knee, you start limping. The next thing you know, you've got a hip problem. You've got a bad foot. Mm-hmm. You start limping. Mm-hmm. The next thing you got a hip problem. Mm-hmm. So you start compensating. And if you come to you and we start using those muscles correctly again,
a lot of that stuff clears up. Like a lot of times people will come to me with three or four issues and I'll say, let's start with the worst one and see what happens from there. Like somebody might have a shoulder problem and a hip problem. I'll treat their hip and then I'll say, we'll treat your shoulder after we finish with your hip. But a lot of times when we're finished treating the hip, the shoulder problem has disappeared. So, you know, a lot of times, a lot of those, your body will create like just this chain reaction of compensation problems, you know, as we try to avoid pain, or we, you know, try to, you know, pain is sort of like the name of the game here. It's like, you know, the brain, we have this paradigm that, you know, if you feel pain, that there must be some physical reason for it. So we go looking for evidence of that pain. And so like there was they had a study, I don't know, it's about 6 or 7 years ago, maybe longer, where they took 30 healthy baseball players that, you know, normally the idea is that if somebody comes in complaining about pain, you want to go get an MRI of their shoulder and see what's going on under the hood and then say, oh, there's evidence. There it is. There's the tear. And so they said, well, we always look at people who are unhealthy or coming in complaining about pain. Let's see what happens if we do MRIs of, you know, let's take the top 30 pitchers who have not reported any pain, have not had any problems, no surgeries, everything's good. They're pitching 100 mile an hour fastballs. Let's see what their shoulders look like. And they did MRIs, and 26 out of the 30 had such significant damage to their rotator cuffs that had they come in reporting pain, the doctors said they would have whisked them right into surgery right away. But they're not having problems. They're still throwing 100 mile an hour balls. So we have this paradigm if you've got something broken, that it's going to hurt. So you can have structural, you know, problems and not have pain.
And it's fine.
Oh yeah, they don't have any problems. They're perfectly fine. They're absolutely fine because, you know, we again think about it. As long as the muscles are able to do their job, and the thing you have to remember is, muscles are the only structure in the body responsible for absorbing or generating force. And so if you are feeling pain, if you've got some joint damage, that's because, you know, it's because you are absorbing force in the joint. That means your muscles aren't doing the job. So our job as NeuFit therapists is to get the force back into the muscle and out of the joint.
Which is why their shoulders didn't hurt, because they were using their muscles correctly.
Well, exactly. So they had damage, but it wasn't hurting. They were, and so a lot of times when I fix somebody's shoulder, like I work with a lot of athletes. I've worked with golfers, tennis players, and you know, I had a guy who had a torn meniscus, and, you know, he had 100% tear. Like that thing was gone. And did his meniscus heal? I don't know. Maybe over time it did, but I can tell you in the month that I worked with him, I don't think it would just reattach and heal. We didn't perform any miracles in that sense. We just taught his muscles the proper firing sequence, and he was able to go back to golf and tennis. He was a former tennis player, pro tennis player, and you know, hiking and running and doing all the stuff that he did, no problems. So, you know, maybe eventually that meniscus healed. I have no idea. But you know, the idea, we just, you know, joints are just more or less hinges. They're not supposed to absorb force.
They're our not muscle, the ones doing the,
if
doing
they
the
are,
work.
The only thing that can damage a joint is like shearing forces. So when you have a muscles that don't operate correctly, like so many, you know, soccer girls were getting ACL tears and they didn't really understand why. And they found out that they did, you know, kind of did a little research on that. It turns out that they did not do as much posterior chain training like boys do. And so they had, you know, weaker hamstrings. And so when they were getting ready to cut right or cut left, they were getting what's called co-contraction, like their hamstrings would contract. But when an agonist contracts, the primary muscle that is supposed to be doing the load, its antagonist is supposed to lengthen. And that's how, biomechanically, that's how our bodies are supposed to function. But if both fire at the same time, then that's what's called co-contraction. And guess what? That force gets all sent into the knee or all goes up into the hip, gets absorbed incorrectly. And so now it takes, you know, and so it doesn't happen just right away. You don't just operate incorrectly one day and boom, you hurt. You know, a lot of guys come to me and say, I was fine until I reached down to pick up the newspaper and boom, my back went out. Well, your back didn't go out then. Your back went out 10 years prior when you started moving poorly, and it just took that long, took that many cycles of incorrect movement to manifest itself into something that you know, looks like pain or injury. So you know, we're basically just adapting the body, the muscles, to do their job and absorb force instead of you putting that force into the joint. And so
I want to read this again from what I got off your website. Whether you are looking to recover from injury or pain, or you are looking to tune up your fitness, you have found the right place. Often people find their way here as a last resort after months or even years of dealing with pain, to the point that they almost accept it as part of getting older. No one should live in daily pain. We approach things at JP Fitness from a completely different angle than traditional therapy does, and we get results far faster. But insurance doesn't pay for what you do.
Actually, what we do is FDA approved, which means there are PT billing codes. I am not a physical therapist, so I don't accept insurance, and I'm not. You know, physical therapists can use this. They in fact, there are two schools right now. Unfortunately, not UCA yet. We'll work on that. But there are two schools so far that are teaching NeuFit in the schools. So the students are coming out, you know, knowing physical therapy, obviously, but also having a good background in neurotherapy with using the NeuFit devices. So it is something that if somebody were a physical therapist or a chiropractor, they could bill insurance theoretically. Now, you know, whether or not the insurance company will pay for it is another story. You know, a lot of times they won't approve something that they don't really know about. I don't know. And I don't really care because it's not my business model. I mean, people just pay me, you know, like I'm just a cash business, or, you know, checks or credit cards or whatever. But I mean, people just come in and pay me.
Yeah. You don't file insurance.
I don't file anything against insurance.
All right. This is a great place to take a break. We're speaking today with certified personal trainer, massage therapist, and NeuFit expert, Mr. Jean Paul Francoeur, a.k.a. JP, from JP Fitness in Little Rock, Arkansas. When we come back, we're going to talk more to this expert on electrical stimulation recovery about the business of being a personal trainer. Are you interested in becoming one and what it took? We might even recap his entrepreneurial story that I'm just charmed by, and tips for the everyday person wanting to improve their health. We'll be right back.
It's the most wonderful time of the year, and flagandbanner.com will help you spread the holiday cheer. From garland to wreaths to ornaments and more, flagandbanner.com has all of your holiday decor. Happy holidays from all of us to all of you, and may all of your Christmases be red, white, and blue.
We're speaking today with JP, owner and founder of JP Fitness in Little Rock, Arkansas. He has been a personal trainer since the 90s and besides...
80s.
Oh, really?
1987.
Oh, wow. We're speaking today with JP, owner and founder of JP Fitness in Little Rock, Arkansas. He has been a personal trainer since the 80s and besides athletic sports trainers, was one of the first in Arkansas to offer quality weight training to everyday persons. Before the break, we talked about NeuFit, this electro, what do you call it exactly?
E-stim therapy, I guess.
E-stim.
Electrical stimulation.
Electrical stimulation recovery. And if you're just now tuning in, you should really go and listen to that part. If you've got chronic pain or want to build your muscles up, this guy knows everything. His vocabulary was kind of crazy, didn't you think?
Yeah, it was very impressive.
I mean, really, he loves what he does. Mm-hmm. A lot of people do what they do because that's just kind of, you know, people ask me sometimes, do you just love flags? And I'm like, well, yeah, I like them, but I don't just love flags. I have customers who love flags.
Yeah.
But you love what you do.
Absolutely. It is. I mean, you know, obviously we all need money to pay the bills, but my real currency is the outcomes that I get. I mean, I have a stroke patient who came to me who, you know, the physical therapists and occupational therapists told him, we have done everything we can do. And this is, you're going to just have to accept the fact that you're never going to get use of this arm again.
Uh-huh.
And you know, that it's just going to be paralyzed.
And now he's playing baseball. No, I'm just
not playing baseball, but you know, he can use his arm though. I mean, he can actually, the day one, we actually got movement out of his arm day one. His wife was there the first day and she just burst into tears. She's like, it was very sweet. It was very sweet. And he's just, you know, now he can drive again. Like I got him ready for the neuro driving test, which is a tough test. You know, it's 3.5 hours of making sure that you can do everything you need to do to safely operate your vehicle and, you know, not hurt anybody. Right. Mm-hmm. And, so that we worked on getting him ready for that for a while. And then, but now we're just kind of, you know, we're just fine tuning stuff. He can raise his arm overhead. He can raise it out to the side. He can rotate his arm. He can use his fingers. He's starting to get back slowly where he can type again. So, I mean, you know, it's a challenge. I mean, it's something I had never dealt with prior to that. Now I've got a couple other people, that I'm doing that with, but just being able to, see the results he gets and just see how much it's changed his life is, you know, it's why I can get up in the morning and just bolt out of bed and say, I'm ready for the day. I want to just get in there and work with people.
10 hours a day, which is 10 different people, one-on-one, which talk about listening and paying attention. Mm-hmm. I mean, that is hard. Most of us go to work our 8 hours a day and we, you know, we zone out for a couple mm-hmm. of those hours, but you actually, you cannot, those guys no. are paying big bucks to have mm-hmm. you in there. They want you paying attention mm-hmm. and you've got to pay attention to heal them. You have to love what mm-hmm. you're doing.
Oh, absolutely. I could not handle the schedule. It would not be sustainable. Really, it's barely sustainable now. But
you are in such demand.
Well, and that's why I opened the new place, honestly. I kind of outgrew my situation. I had a home-based studio for years, and it was good. I mean, I was very successful in it, and I did really well. But I really kind of outgrew it about 3 years ago, and I started looking for buildings a couple of years ago. And then I had a couple of failed attempts, and then I ended up, you know, renting a spot over on R Street in that plaza. And that has just been like a wonderful.
Well, now you can hire people.
So, that's what I did. I trained a team and I got them ready before I even opened the place. I had a few certified people and now I've got a team of about 4 people right now. And, I got one in training, getting ready to come up and start working. So, you know, the idea is that I can kind of oversee other people doing therapies and, you know, I can make a bigger splash and
help
not just,
more people.
Exactly.
I mean, you had reached the limit of how many people you could help.
You know, and that, but the demand was not getting less. It was just getting more. And, you know, which is great because honestly, I did not do any advertising or marketing for any of that. It's just very organic.
No, people come and try it one time. I used to train with you years ago and then I mm-hmm. quit for a while. And then I saw you at the gym, one of those franchise mm-hmm. big gyms, and was whining about something, mm-hmm. my knee or something. And you said, Kerry, when are you going to come in and let me fix you? And I was like, whatever. So I go in there one session. I'm like, okay, this is it. I can see why it grows mm-hmm. and people don't want to quit.
Yeah. Well, because just what you were saying, you know, once we get people out of pain, they feel so good that they can also quickly see the writing on the wall. They're like, oh my gosh, this stuff works for fitness as well. So in the same sense of being able to quickly get you out of pain, I can also augment or enhance physical performance. So I can place the pads in certain areas and you know, I change the frequencies when I use a different frequency when I'm training people, but I can actually make the muscle sort of grow. I can sculpt the muscle. I can actually make your, you know, your glutes or your shoulders pop, you know,
We talked about how you a lot about chronic pain and recovery mm-hmm. at the last segment, mm-hmm. but you also train people for competition.
Mm-hmm. Well, not bodybuilding, but yes.
I saw your girl you trained for competition last year.
Oh, you're right. I forgot about that. You're right. Yeah. I guess I did. You're right.
I mean, you could bounce a quarter off of her butt. I'm telling you, this girl, she
sculpted.
You could. I think her butt was almost bulletproof, frankly. It was like, yeah. she did get some massive, very muscular glutes, that's for sure.
Yes. So you don't do that very much?
Well, yeah. I mean, you know, I think most people who come to me just want to, you know, I'd say probably a majority of my clients are, you know, well, I say 50 plus. I have a wide range. I work with everything from like, you know, teenage athletes, soccer players, football players, you know, baseball player, whatever, sport people, kids in sports to, you know, but I'd say the majority of my fitness clients are usually 40s, 50s, 60s.
Well, that's because they're the only ones that can afford you.
That might be the case.
But it's very expensive.
Yeah, you know, it's relative, I guess.
So this speaks to how rich people live longer and...
Well, yeah, they have better access to things.
To food. To to you and to just their quality of life. But if you're not a rich person and you wanted to, you know, train, what would you tell people to do?
Well, I mean, you know, you can get a membership at a gym and just go, you know, work out. Like I still do dry workouts, as I call them, you know, when I'm not attached to a machine, I still mm-hmm. do dry workouts myself, just every now and then, just kind of mix it in. So,
you broke your toe, which is why you just had surgery.
Well, that's different.
You got to be careful when you go free weights at the gym mm-hmm, mm-hmm. and you overload because you hurt your joints.
Well, that's true. That's true.
You hurt your toe joint.
Mm-hmm. Well,
yeah. We're not all trying to look like superheroes like JP over
there. So I just want to tell everybody to go to your website and go to that thing that says about us and click on that because you're half dressed in that thing.
Well, that's not up to date. By the way, we had updated that where we did a photo shoot and we did all this stuff. And then I had a new person take over my website and they updated it based on the old website, not the new one.
Well, so don't take that picture off.
Oh, I'm taking it off.
No. Okay, everybody run and look at it. You can count his six pack. Your thighs are enormous. How old are you in that picture?
That was about 3 years ago, so about 52,
yeah, that's,
I guess,
like a different level of interacting with the
if
gym.
And let's speak to that, because not everybody can look like JP, no matter what you are, because they now got this thing where you do 23andMe and you send it off and you find out your DNA. Uh-huh. And JP, tell us about DNA, because it is some weird stuff. I'm a mesomorph?
Mesomorphic. Yeah, I think you are. I think you're a mesomorphic. And
that's a skinny person.
Yeah, there's, well, no, no, mesomorph is rectangular. They're more like, that's the more athletically built people.
Oh, no, what am I? What's the skinny person?
That's an ectomorph. Morph.
I'm an ectomorph.
And endomorphs are more heavily built.
You're a
mesomorph. Yeah. Yeah. Well, there's things that genetically can give people a leg up on you know, like sports performance. Mm-hmm. Like most of your runners and jumpers and throwers, there's a gene called ACTN3 that if you don't have it, you're not going to find anybody in the elite level that does not have ACTN3, which basically, I'm going to have to go off deep memory. It synthesizes, you synthesize protein differently. They typically are they're a little leaner. It's kind of easier for them. You know, they have a lot more power. I read a book called The Sports Gene by David Epstein, which I highly recommend. It's a great book. But he talked about that. He talked about why Jamaican sprinters were like the fastest people in the world. So apparently, you know, back when they were doing the slave trade and they took all these West African people to Jamaica. And they were just incredibly powerful and fast people. So their ancestors had survived a malaria outbreak like generations before. And so the people who were best suited for survival had a combination of two genes, ACTN3, and they had a single copy of the sickle cell gene, which, you know, I guess, you know, sickle cell anemia is something that really saps, you know, your oxygen. So I guess the combination of those two meant that they could really just produce a lot of power in this low oxygen environment, very anaerobic. So there was actually 1 year, in fact, where Jamaica won in a 100-meter dash, they won first and third, and the second place winner was American of Jamaican descent. so their gene pool, you know, they have those, that combination of the ACTN3, but you know, you'll see that in like any elite athlete of any race will have, like, if you can't make it to that level if you don't have that
gene. Do you have that gene?
Yes, actually I do. I checked out the 23andMe, it was like one of the first places I went. I was like, okay, let's see if I have that. And sure enough, I did.
So. Well, that's why there's that naked picture of you online. It's so good.
Well, you know, I do have to work at it. Nobody can look like that. It's not, it's a lot easier to maintain something than it is to go back and get it after you've lost it. And I've just, you know, I do have, I've always been sort of fit, you know, my whole life. I've played sports and so I've always stayed pretty fit, you know, I mean.
But not really, because you weren't into the gym until you fell into it when you were like 18 years old.
Well, yeah, I was, when I was 18, I was a wrestler and a pole vaulter.
Oh.
And yeah, in high school, that was my sports. I had schools looking at me to come wrestle, you know, D1 wrestling. And I ended up with a music scholarship offer from Arkansas. That's how I came here originally, was because I was a classical guitarist. And
he's not just any old jarhead.
I remember this.
So I thought that, you know, well, and this is pre-internet days. So I moved down to Arkansas and I thought, well, I'll just take the music scholarship and I'll just walk on the wrestling team, whatever wrestling team. They'll be happy to have, you know, someone with my experience to walk in. And I thought I'd just walk right in and, yeah, here we go. I want to join your team. And then I got here, registered for my classes and got everything kind of settled in. And I started calling around trying to find the wrestling coach. And I found out there was no wrestling in Arkansas. So I was like, what? And then I started calling high schools to see if I could at least assistant coach and keep my feet wet. And there was no wrestling at all in
the
state of Arkansas.
So you started wrestling?
No, I did not. I just kind of accepted my fate. I was 18. I didn't have my crap together. So, yeah. so it wasn't until years later, Greg Hatcher, is the one who brought wrestling to Arkansas single-handedly, like literally hired, a world-class, like, four-time national championship, wrestler, a guy named Pat Smith, and they started a wrestling academy. And then he donated, mats and singlets to like all these schools. I mean, just, you know, extremely expensive endeavor, but he literally put Arkansas on the wrestling map within 2 years. They were basically keeping up with Oklahoma, Kansas, all these big wrestling states. We're up there now. And that's literally because of him. But that was unfortunately way after I was out of college. So.
Did you get involved with Greg about that?
No, not on that. No, I worked out obviously with him and his wife, but I was not involved in the wrestling thing. By then that ship had sailed.
I
moved here to Arkansas for a music scholarship, but, then I, you know, the first year, of course, I was just like, I was eating pizza and, you know, not taking care of my health, doing some other things that might not be too healthy for me.
And I decided
in 1988 or 87, I mean, I decided to just take a year and I took off and I went back to Massachusetts, and I lived there for almost a year. And I took a job in a factory and I started working out, and cause I'd just gotten a little pudgy for me, you know, I probably wasn't that pudgy, but you know, my perception of myself at the time, I was like, man, I've really let myself go. And I started reading about it and started really getting into it and got really, 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 really ripped. I mean, just in the best shape of my life. And bunch of people at the gym noticed. So next thing you know, I'm taking this little certification test and I'm starting to help people at the gym just kind of part time and just for fun. And so I moved back to Arkansas, in 88 and, And my first, one of my first jobs when I got back was working for Gold's Gym under David Basil. He was, you know, longtime friend now, and he was very much a mentor in my early stages of this. And, you know, I still had no idea that this was going to be my career, but I just loved it. I still loved it. I was, you know, I worked out with people, and I was always kind of like, it was always a learning process for me. You know, I mean, I was very passionate, so I could get results with people, but I, you know, I mean, looking back on it now, I'm like, man. I was back then, I used to charge a whopping $15 an hour. And I can tell you now it's probably overpaid, but, but you know, I mean, I lacked in experience, I made up for in passion and willingness to learn and willingness to dive deep and figure things out.
So everybody needs to go back and listen to our 2017 show. Cause you go really into depth about those years, and it really checks all the boxes of an entrepreneurial story about mm-hmm. working with integrity, about mm-hmm. being responsible, about keeping your eyes open for opportunities, doing the work, and not being afraid to take entrepreneurial leaps. Because mm-hmm. you left Gold Gyms, you know.
I floated for a little bit. I was around in a few other gyms, but
you left Gold Gyms mm-hmm. in kind of a storm.
Yeah.
And this is how you know that you truly do love and care what you do. Tell our listeners in a short synopsis, because we're running out of time,
okay,
what you did for AIDS patients and why it culminated and why you ended up opening your own gym.
Right. So that actually was the impetus or the catalyst, I should say. So in a nutshell, I had this idea just as I was getting, you know, further into fitness that people living with AIDS, because that was kind of a relevant issue in the, you know,
it was
in the,
new.
It was not new, but it was definitely still kind of like, you know, it was still new, you know, newish in the '80s and late '80s. And I was convinced that if people living with AIDS were to, you know, exercise and take charge of their fitness, like really be proactively healthy, like eat healthy and exercise and stay hydrated and all this other stuff, that they could actually, you know, improve their lifestyle and, you know, in some ways maybe just, you know, enhance their lives and maybe live longer lives. And so I went down to the Ryan White Center downtown, and I gave a little speech, you know, to the nurses and doctors, and they said, okay, well, we like it. We want to try it. So I was like, what? And they offered to, they said, well, where do you work? We'd like to send you some people. We can bus them in from, they were sending them from Jefferson Memorial in Pine Bluff. And so I got this big corporate membership for them, and they were busing them in every day to work out with me. And I was getting really good results. Like, I mean, you know, I had a guy who, like literally he could almost not take a full step. And within 3 months he was doing lunges, full lunges across the floor. But they were an eclectic group of people. I mean, they did draw some attention, you know, some, they were very flamboyant, and you know, there's everything from, ex crack whores to, you know, flamboyant young men with bleached out hair and a couple that looked like they were from the Village People, you know, with a handlebar mustache and, you know, just kind of, you know, they were very, you know, they really did stand out, but I mean, I loved them. They were great people. They were so much fun. But you know, I was working at kind of a, you know, it was a little bit of a redneck gym, you know? And so I kind of shielded them from, you know, any people that might want to mess with them or say something mean to them, you know? Anyway, word got out that the people that I was training had AIDS. But it was known up front to management because I told them, you know,
right.
but once
patrons,
it got out,
yeah,
they decided to fire me. Mm-hmm. And the manager at the time was like, well, yeah. And I said, well, then I'll just buy a membership and I'll just train them. He said, well, we reserve the right to, you know, it's a private gym. We reserve the right to sell memberships to who we wish. And you're not, you are barred from the gym from now on. So I had to basically walk out, but I was really pissed. And I said, don't think I don't see what you're doing here. This is outright discrimination. And I said, you know what I'm going to do to get around this? I'm just going to open up my own place. And he kind of looked at me and he said, you just do that.
No, let's not tell the rest of the story.
Okay,
they got to go back and watch 2017 because we're running out of time.
You did
every entrepreneurial thing that you should do, the work in the two jobs. Mm-hmm, and there's mm-hmm, a great mm-hmm. irony twist at Gold's mm-hmm. Gym that comes back that people should really go listen to. Do you have any recommendations for someone interested in getting into the business of personal training today? It's a lot different today than it was when you started. You were like one in few.
Yeah.
You were getting national publicity because they were so few of you.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you have any recommendation for people today?
Well, I mean, don't I don't pursue it as a career if you just because some, you know, don't go to a guidance counselor thinking this is going to be like a big moneymaker for you. I did not get into this because I just thought I was going to make so much money. I just loved what I did. And I tried to figure out a way to make money doing what I love to do. So if it's just something you really just are, you know, you lose sleep over it, you're thinking about it when you fall asleep, you know, you're reading books on it, you know, you have a, that's a pretty good indication that you might, this might be a good field for you.
Yeah. You're an avid reader.
Yeah. If you're, well, it doesn't even have to be an avid reader. Just, you know, some, I am. Yes. Yes. But I mean, you know, I like to research. I like to, you know, educate myself. And, you know, ironically, my college education was mostly fine arts, you know, and
because you're a musician.
And yeah, fine arts and also just human behavior. I was a philosophy major for a while. I was a psych major for a while. I was a, you know, a writing major for a while.
Did you graduate from college?
No, I did not. I have 15 hours left and 15 hours. I literally opened my business my senior year and I thought I would just finish it out. And I just got, and I didn't think I'd be that busy. Like in my financial projections, when I wrote my business plan, I estimated it would take me, you know, 12 months to get to 12 clients, which would, you know, be my, I needed 4.8 to break even on my rent and expenses. And I thought it would take me, and I had 12 clients in the first, you know, I was over 20 clients in the first month.
You've opened another
right,
gym now.
I had to hire people and all that stuff. And so I really grew fast. And then I just got so busy, I ended up kind of dropping out and I just haven't gone back and finished it. And so, you know, but I mean, I also got like over 140 hours of classes. So I, you know, you only needed 104 back in those days to graduate from UALR.
But
and
you got to stick to one
so
thing.
So I did not stick. I had like just some requirements out there that I didn't finish.
You needed a better guidance counselor, you know, who would give
maybe.
You a pass.
You know, the thing is, I wasn't there to you know, build my career. I was really there to learn. I do love learning.
You do love learning.
I'm a nerd. You know, mm-hmm. I admit it.
You're a hot nerd. All right. Well, we're speaking today with JP from JP Fitness in Little Rock, Arkansas. He is a certified personal trainer. He is a licensed massage therapist, but that is not his career. And he only does it to help you through some chronic pain. Don't call him up and think you're going to get to go lie on a table and listen to waterfalls. Because that's not his deal. He's a certified NeuFit therapist and trainer, and he does use some of his massage qualities to help you through your pain. When we come back, we're going to talk about, you know, what you can do if you can't afford a gym or even a personal trainer. I mean, there are great gyms out there that you can join, franchise gyms, and we're going to find out what you can do in your own home. It's all about creating a habit and getting used to the habit. We'll be right back.
Do you have something to say? Say it in flying colors. I'm Kerry McCoy, owner of flagandbanner.com, where flags tell stories and banners get attention. Whether it's for your business, organization, or special event, custom flags and banners will make your message soar. Visit flagandbanner.com for high quality, quick turnaround. We're not just any flag company, we're the experts that answer the phone.
We're speaking today with Mr. Jean Paul Francoeur, a.k.a. JP, who recently opened yet another personal gym in Little Rock, Arkansas. He just can't help himself. He's a visionary with a passion for helping people. So we've talked about NeuFit and how it helps you to recover from injury or build muscle or just circumvent problems that happen through the aging process. And then we talked about some entrepreneurial stuff in the second segment. And now let's talk about what everybody's talking about, which is rich people are the only ones that get to live to be 104 years old because they're the only ones that can afford you, afford good foods, you know, have a lifestyle that's healthy. So let's talk about if you can't afford you and you want to do something at home, mm-hmm. What would you suggest a layman do?
Well, you don't actually have to join a gym to exercise. In fact, I didn't have a gym membership. I mean, besides, you know, like, I mean, I didn't have a gym membership for years. I just worked out of my house. You know, After I sold my gym in 2008, honestly, I was burned out of gyms for a while. I didn't step foot in a gym and I had no interest in going into a gym. I was like, once you've seen how the sausage is made, you don't really want to, you know, it's like, oh, it just depressed me thinking about going into a gym. Now I don't mind it. You know, I'm kind of, you know, I've had enough time to.
So what is that? 2008, you sold your big
gym. It was a 15 year gap before I reopened. I was working originally when I started doing this in 2009, I was going to people's homes and I was working them at their home. So I'm literally, like, some people had a home gym, some people didn't, and it didn't matter. I brought all the equipment with me that they needed, and, you know, whether it's kettlebells or dumbbells or whatever. And I hauled a little table along with me so I could do the stretching and all that stuff. And eventually I ended up setting up a home studio, and then I moved into a house that had a much bigger space for a better home studio. And I kind of equipped that thing out, but
now you got a gym again. You're back into the gym business.
They kept pulling me back in.
You can't help myself. Well, you're in such demand. If you're at home,
you can. You just
bands. You know, you're big into bands.
I like bands. I like kettlebells. I like, you know, you can get a set of adjustable dumbbells. I mean, there's a lot of different things you can do with a very small amount of space to be able to build a good strong body. And it's just, you know, you don't have to have like an expensive gym. You don't have to be hooked up to electrodes that are stimulating your muscles. I mean, that all that stuff helps. But what really is the most important factor in your success is just some level of consistency, making sure you're getting enough sleep. You know, make sure you try to get 8 hours of sleep a night. Make sure that you're staying hydrated. I for the kind of stuff that I do, on average, I'd say, you know, the regular demand is, people say that you're supposed to have half your body weight in ounces of water. For what I do, I ask people to drink their body weight in water. So, like, in ounces of water. So
there's,
like,
no way.
Yeah, I drink. Okay, so this thing right here holds 24 ounces. I drink a minimum of 8 of these a day.
Well, that's because you're that weird gene. Well, you can do all kinds of weird stuff.
Remember that when it comes to this type of training, you have much higher metabolic demands. So you have to consume more protein. You have to drink more water.
You just have to go to the bathroom all the time if you drink that much water.
I'm normal. I don't go to the bathroom any more than anybody else.
If I try to drink very much water, I go to the bathroom all day long. Well, I can't even get to the bathroom.
Maybe we should talk about doing some pelvic floor work with you.
My husband will probably like that. No,
different kind of pelvic floor work.
That's out of my scope, by the way. I will refer out all that kind of work. But no, drink lots of water, stay hydrated, get lots of sleep. You know,
you're really big on sleep.
I am big on sleep. Sleep, oh my gosh.
You monitor your own sleep.
I do. I wear this little wristband here, and I track my sleep. I track my heart rate variability at night, my deep sleep, my...
How much does a wristband like that cost?
I can't remember. I think this was like $200 and I pay like $10 a night, $10 a month for the sleep study. But I think there's one you can get for Whoop. I think you can get for free or very inexpensively. But it's like a $20 a month, subscription. So it kind of works out to be even, I guess, at some point. But, there's also a ring that you can get called Aura Ring that does the same thing. So those are really good tracking devices. Or if you have an Apple Watch, they have that, those track HRV. You can track your sleep.
So you highly recommend tracking your sleep.
I think sleep. Yeah. Just, I think if you get in the mode of tracking it, you start getting better about discipline. Cause you start, you know, it's like when you start getting good at something, you start doing it more and you start paying attention to it more and you start noticing, hey, I slept really good. My recovery was really high and I'm really on top of my stuff today, you know? So that's the main thing, is if you're getting sleep, it's better for you cognitively. You know, it's very bad. Of course, you know, as well as anyone, that I am as ADHD as they get. Mm-hmm. And one of the number one things that helps people with ADHD is getting lots of sleep. So you know, I try to get at least 8 hours of sleep a night. Sometimes it's only 7, but primarily, usually I get about 8 hours, 7 or 8 hours.
What about walking?
Walking is great.
Dogs.
Absolutely.
I have thought about getting a dog so that I will be forced into walking twice a day.
You live right next to the best set of trails in the city. You just walk across the street and drop down into the park and walk a circuit and you're done. It's beautiful. You don't need a dog.
How long do you have to walk?
I just walk the circuit. You don't have to do anything significant. Just like, you know, a couple miles is great. A
couple miles is a lot.
Okay. If you say so.
I mean,
maybe a mile, you know, just, I mean, it doesn't, it, you know, I mean, the funny thing is, you know, all this exercise that we do right now is kind of ironic. You know, we didn't used to have to exercise, right? I mean, you know, life was challenging enough on its own.
Right.
You know, people were, you know, you just had, you know, we had hard labor. So we actually started exercising in the modern times because we wanted to, because we weren't doing all, everything was so convenient. We didn't have to do all this labor. So we had to sort of pretend like we're doing all this labor on our body. We sort of put ourselves through all these different exercises to try to induce, you know, fatigue in the muscles and the nervous system so that we, you know, so that we could be healthier because, you know, we were healthier before we had all these gyms and everything. I mean, look at, look at the nation now. I mean, we've got all this availability and, but the nation is fat because most people don't have a regular exercise routine. They don't eat correctly. They don't, you know, take care of themselves.
Talk about diet. Do you coach on calorie intake?
Yeah, ultimately weight loss is about calories. You know, I mean, I think that the quality of what you eat is very important. Like I'm big into eating organic, you know, and, if you have a hard time affording that kind of stuff, you know, a lot of people raise their own. I know some very poor people who have a garden and it's very cheap and they eat extremely well.
Well, they talk about how it's expensive to eat right, but I disagree with that. Canned foods, which I eat probably every other day, a canned food. It is just green beans, water, and salt.
Well, yeah. I mean, you know,
and they say you
plain
lock
old green beans are just as good. You know, you get fresh green beans.
But they say sometimes that the can locks in the freshness better and that sometimes it's more nutritional to eat canned foods.
I haven't done any research on that, so I can't speak as an expert on that particular thing. But I'll just say eating plenty of vegetables, eating lots of, you know, making sure you're getting enough protein, you know, making sure that you're, you know,
you're big on protein.
I am big on, well, especially with regards to what I do, because I'm doing such like one workout on the newbie is equivalent to about 10 workouts metabolically. So one of the big benefit to training on the newbie is that you get all the metabolic benefits of heavy lifting, which is where that's what we need for, you know, nice, strong, lean muscle tissue and, you know, burning off the fat. That's all about, but as you get older, it gets harder. It has a much higher risk to benefit ratio because you know, connective tissue can't really handle heavy loads. It might get damaged and that's where you start getting in pain. And I can't tell you how many people are in CrossFit that are my age and everything is broken on them.
You're not a big CrossFit guy.
I mean, I respect the idea of intense short circuits of intense workouts.
Ambition that it takes to do
that. There's a lot of problems in the business model. The business wise, they're doing great, but there's a lot of, I get a lot of people from there because they do tend to, you know, a lot of people tend to get injured. If you notice, a lot of those places are attached to chiropractic clinics or something, there's a reason for that. They kind of feed each other.
Do you ever eat fast food?
Like I eat Chipotle sometimes. I guess that's fast food.
That doesn't count.
I don't eat fast food at all. I will not. I refuse to eat like a hamburger from McDonald's or Burger King or that kind of stuff. I don't. I guess I'm a snob. You know, I'm at the stage of life where I can afford to be a snob. But I won't eat that stuff. It's like the way they raise the animals is stressful on the animal and they've got a lot of chemicals and hormones and all that stuff in it.
And put flavor enhancers and they put chemical cravings in it. So you crave it again.
Absolutely. So I don't want to eat anything like that. Yeah. I just like eating clean, you know, right now I'm kind of in a crossroads because I've been eating, based on my gut health. I took a gut health test and figured out that all the things that I'd been 4.5 years, I did not eat gluten, sugar, or dairy. And then I come to find out I did this gut test and I found out that my gut's actually completely fine with all three of those things, but I couldn't eat. I have a reaction to like carrots, corn,
grapes.
No, not grapes weren't on my list. Lemons. I don't know. There's a bunch of stuff, peanuts, you know, I had some stuff that I had to avoid for about six months, and your gut can kind of repair itself.
So
if you
can
do
eat
that.
Wheat again.
So I was able to eat wheat again and sure enough, I ate wheat and I didn't have any issues with it. But that's not to say that, you know, it is kind of inflammatory food. If I do eat wheat, it's usually going to be like in the form of farro or some sort of, you know, fresh grain. It's not going to be like, I won't eat any like big brand cereals, you know, or that kind of stuff. That's, in America, we harvest our wheat too early, you know, like what we call organic food in Italy, they just call it food. they don't allow any imports of anything that's been raised with like Monsanto, you know, like all the weed killers and pesticides. They won't allow any of that in their country. They won't import any foods that are raised with that. They won't import any. And so all the, everything that they do there, they is just, that's just food. And that's the way I feel like it should be here. But, you know, we just have a, I guess we've just got a bigger country and we've got to figure out ways to feed more people. So they have ways to enhance harvests that are not necessarily long-term healthy for us. But I would like, I wish we could adopt, you know, do a whole paradigm shift and just eat like they do. Cause they can eat wheat. They can, you can eat the pasta there and it's perfectly healthy.
I can too. Yeah.
But the, you know, and they harvest their wheat when it's mature and they don't use any pesticides on it. And they don't use, you know, we use that glyphosate or whatever, you know, I mean, we use all these chemicals on
what
our crops.
What do you see for the future of America's health?
I think we're just going to have a, you know, nothing ever gets done until there is a radical, you know, until something is just collapses. I think we're just going to have some kind of collapse of a system where we just have to go into some sort of Manhattan Project mentality on we've got to revamp fitness in America. Go Google fitness education, physical education in 1962, right after the Kennedy Fitness Challenge, and they you know, like the average boys in 1962 could do, you know, 15 push-ups and 10 pull-ups. I mean, they right now our military readiness is down because they can't recruit half the kids who come in can't even do a single push-up or a single pull-up. That's scary. You know, I mean, that's like, everybody should be able to do that. Right. And, but you know, these young kids are especially at that age, like 18 years old, they can't do any of it. So, you know, we're going to have some sort of like, and I tried to do something about this when I was chairman of the Governor's Council on Fitness. I tried to bring in PE, and man, I'm telling you, I met with opposition. You know who I got the most opposition from was from the school systems. And they were saying, well, we have a literacy problem. These kids aren't, you know, they can't read. And I'm like, I would be like, they will do better in school. They won't have as many behavioral problems. They will learn better if they're exercising every day. Cause we did in the 70s, you know, we were, when I was a kid, you know, when I was a kid, you know, sorry, I didn't make it sound like an old person. But my age, in my day, we did PE every day. We had to dress out, shower, and, you know, we sweat our butts off. We had to climb ropes and learn to play tag football and tennis and all that. Everything. We just had to use our bodies and do a lot of calisthenics and, you know, kids don't do any of that anymore. And we're all capable of it. That's the problem. We're all capable of it, but we've become so like focused on devices and, you know, our digital, our phones and our computers and our TV. And it's like, we've become very sedentary. So until we have an absolute collapse of our, you know, some branch of our economy or something like that, where we just, you know, we can't sustain, you know, all the people who are too obese to be employed and they can't work and function on a regular basis. Until we get to that point when the train finally crashes, then I think we'll turn things around. But until then, we're just going to, you know, people will just keep, you know, spending money on
fast food.
And
we're speaking today with JP from JP Fitness in Little Rock, Arkansas, who has been in the business of helping people put on muscle, get out of pain, and circumvent the aging process. We'll recap the show, tell you how to contact JP, and I'll ask JP to finish this sentence. Every day, everyone who can should. We'll be right back.
Hey, Hog fans. It's time to get Razorback ready. Call those hogs to victory. At Flag and Banner, we have all your game day swag. Hog hats, license plates, banners, flags, and more. Come bust out your Arkansas pride today.
We're speaking today with Jean Paul Francoeur, affectionately known as JP. He's the owner and founder of JP Fitness in Little Rock, Arkansas. You've done so much, JP. What are you most proud of?
Wow, you just like have to throw me a curveball, don't you?
Yeah, got to. Every day of my life. You've done a lot.
Well, I mean,
every decade you've reinvented yourself.
I really have. I think the thing that I'm most proud of is that I'm not locked into any, I'm not static in any, I don't have any, like, every view that I have is able to be changed if new evidence is presented. You know,
I mean, you're open-minded.
I'm very open-minded, and
obvious and, by his AIDS that he did in the 80s when you were
I've always been a friend of mine actually said, you know, JP, you've always been about 20 years ahead of Arkansas, because I was you know, the first person to open up a like a private training studio and back in the 90s, early 90s, and then we, you know, but I worked with, you know, and I work with any population. I just think that fitness should be for everyone. It should not just be for people who, you know, or athletes, or, you know, I think that, you know, if you're not going to be an athlete, you still should be exercising every day. You should still should be riding your bike or doing lots of walking, or, you know, do some calisthenics, push-ups, pull-ups, you know, that kind of thing. Just keep your body moving and healthy, you know, garden or do some physical, some sort of manual physical, you know, exercise, or even labor. If you have a physical job, you don't need to worry about that as much. But
finish this sentence. Every day, everyone who can should...
I hate to be broad, but just exercise.
That is too broad.
That is too broad?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, you should be able to squat. We have six primal movement patterns that our bodies are capable of. That's squat, deadlift, lunge, push, pull, and rotate. That's the six things that we do. And everything we do, whether we're going up the stairs or whatever, you know, is some combination of those six movement patterns. So
say them again.
A squat, deadlift, lunge, push, pull, or rotate. So like anytime you're doing a push-up, you're pushing. If you're pulling up, you're pulling. If you're, you know, you can lunge with a medicine ball, that's lunge combined with, you know, twist, or you can just do some cable exercises or band exercises, or just hold a weight and rotate. You know, I mean, you can just, there, you can just make sure that your body is capable of moving in those six primal movement patterns.
You could do all six of those. You can do it. Yeah,
you can do it
in
15 minutes. Yeah, absolutely.
While you're waiting on your coffee, because I just stand there and stare at my coffee pot. I could do one of those each.
You could. You could do. You could do some reverse lunges, or, you know,
I could just squat down to the floor. I could twist.
You know, pick up something. No, like you know, pick up something off the floor. You know, that's deadlifting. You know, I mean, those are all things that we have to do. If you pick up a bag of grain from the floor, you're lifting dead weight. That's a deadlift. If you're sitting down and standing back up out of a chair, you're squatting. You know.
Let's recap. NeuFit, electrical stimulation machine.
Helps. It will help us as we age by preventing muscle loss, by preventing atrophy, by actually still building muscle. Even with my clients in their 60s and 70s, I mean, they're fit. I mean, I got some clients. One of my clients this morning, he's 67 years old, and the guy, I train him like an athlete, like a young professional athlete. He's got abs. He's got.
Did he when he came to you?
No.
How long has he been training with you?
15 years.
Oh, that's a long time.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, I mean, you were with me like over 30 years ago.
I was in your first gym down there.
Yeah, and I'm still training one of my clients that you knew back then. I've been training him continuously for the last 30 years. So, you know, I've got a lot of long timers.
So I learned about you from Parade Magazine back when they used to have the newspaper.
Is that how you found out about me?
Yes, they had a newspaper, and inside of the newspaper was Parade Magazine that was everybody always got and pulled out on Sunday.
Yeah.
And there was a guy from Arkansas. And I just had my son, Jack McCoy, and I was like, well, I'm going to go down there. And I got such quick results that my husband decided to join. So we started doing
that.
It.
I remember. That was so great. I loved it.
So how do people get in touch with you?
Call the gym at 501-916-2541 or visit the website, jpfitness.com, www.jpfitness.com.
JPFitness.com, you can actually book an appointment online there. At least I saw the button. Yeah. If you click on that.
There is. You can't book with me, but you can book with my other people.
Well, you don't have any more room.
That's why I have that one kind of blocked off. I'm maxed out. But you can also email info@jpfitness.com and you know, someone will get back with you and set up, you know, help set up a time.
Well, and even if they do work out with one of your trainers, which I have worked out with the other ones too, they're fantastic.
Oh, they are.
You've taught them all how to do, and y'all all talk all the time.
And they have great personalities. And nobody's going to get in my realm if they're not like fun to talk to.
Thank you, JP. And thank you for caring and for helping so many people.
Well, thank you too. And I love this. I love it when you get all up in my business. You do every morning anyway. So, you know, this time we're doing it on your show. So.
That's right. You're one of a kind. Don't ever change.
I won't.
All right. Here's your gift.
I get a gift? Oh, sweet.
Okay.
This is for me.
So I didn't know you lived in Massachusetts.
Well, it wasn't like a home state. I just lived there.
And didn't you live in Colorado?
I did. I lived in Colorado and Tennessee. I went to high school in Tennessee.
I got those two and Arkansas and U.S. Wow. For our listeners, I just gave JP a desk set 4x6-inch flags of all the states he's lived in so that he can take it back and put it in his gym.
Thank you. That's very sweet.
You're welcome. In closing,
and give me 20. Push-ups, that is.
Say that for tomorrow morning.
To our listeners, this show was recorded in the hallowed walls of Taborian Hall in Little Rock, Arkansas, and made possible by the good works of flagandbanner.com, our audio engineer and local celeb, Mr. Tom Wood, summa cum laude videographer, Mr. Jonathan Hankins, production manager, my daughter, Miss Megan Pittman, and my co-host, Mr. Grady McCoy IV, a.k.a. Sun Gray. Thank you for spending time with us. We hope you've heard or learned something that's been inspiring or enlightening, and that it, whatever it is, will help you up your business, your independence, or your life. I'm Kerry McCoy, and I'll see you next time on the radio. Until then, be brave and keep it up.
If you like this video, subscribe to our YouTube channel by clicking on the picture in the center of the screen. For more of Kerry's interviews, click either video on the right of the screen. And as always, thank you for watching.